Start, sir. 8-4.
Yeah.
Gradually, participants are joining.
Yeah, let them come and join. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Good evening, one and all. So, thank you for this opportunity. Second time in front of you. Once again here, but this time I am going to talk the advances in additive manufacturing processes. So that is my talk now. So let me start with the classification of 3D printing or additive manufacturing processes. Recently, ASTM has standardized the classification of additive manufacturing into 7 groups. So these are the 7 groups. But again, this is my busy presentation. I have to cover all 7 processes with the recent developments. So let me start with VAT photopolymerization process. That is the first additive manufacturing process. Even in fact, it was the first developed by 3D Systems by actually Charles Hull was the person who invented this VAT photopolymerization process. Earlier, it used to call it SLA, that is stereolithography operators. And he himself started a company called 3D Systems. So let me start with that first category of VAT photopolymerization process. And then material jetting, there is another category from ASTM. They have standardized into grouping them into material jetting is another category of binder jetting, material extrusion. Nowadays, it is very popular. Why? Because all these desktop FDM printers will come under this material extrusion process. Sheet lamination is another process, and powder bed is another process. We'll see in detail, and directed energy deposition. So these are the 7 processes recently ASTM has standardized into 7 groups. And like if it is apt to put for post-processing techniques also here along with the 7 processes. And finally, of course, still there are some fabrication challenges are there. So with that, I will conclude my talk. So if you recollect the classifications given by various people right from the Marshall Burns during 1993 and Croth et al 1998. So earlier they have classified this technology and into a baseline technology, means if you are using lasers, they have grouped them into a laser based additive manufacturing or 3D printing systems, and printer based technologies, they have created a group called printer technologies. And extrusion-based systems, they have called as extrusion-based technology. So that was the initial classification given by the during 90s. Then even subsequently, Chua Chikai, so he has come out with a different kind of classification in 1998. That is with the initial form of the raw material. So this is very popular classification given by the Chua. That is liquid based and solid based and the powder based systems. And there is a slight modification in the Chua classification, the DT form in 2010. He has added the other dimension to the same, instead of 3, he made it as a 4, that is liquid polymer, discrete particle, a molten material and solid sheet. The form of raw material, and he has added one more dimension to this form of raw material is 1D channels, that is a single laser or a single extrusion head. So that was the classification, and 2 into 1D channel means 2 laser beams or 2 heads, 2 deposition heads like that. And then subsequently, so you have very good developments like RAF 1D channels, means like whatever you call this jetting technologies, like inkjet kind of a technologies where you have series of orifices where the raw material or the binder will jet from these nozzles. So that is RAF 1D channel. And subsequently, And of course, a bit faster than the previous systems, that is a 1D channel. So where you can create a mask in means entire layer can be realized in a single go. Maybe very soon, so we can see one more classification here with the 3D channel, hopefully. So that may be the holography or a kind of a technology where a 3D, entire 3D model can it be, maybe quite possible. Maybe we can hope in the future, such kind of addition in this classification. But ASTM F42 committee, so they have classified all the additive manufacturing systems into 7 groups. Anyway, we'll see one by one. So my intention here is to talk about the material compatibility. So if you see a directed energy, so earlier you used to have only one category of material. I'm talking about when it was started, but now you have a reasonably a good minimum of 2 and maximum of 3 categories of material. For example, you take directed energy deposition, so it can process metals as well as ceramics. And coming to powder bed fusion system, so it can process polymers, metals, and sand. And coming to binder jetting systems, so sand, metal, and ceramics. And coming to material extrusion, polymer, food, and living cells. So material jetting, you have a polymers and wax. And sheet lamination, you have a metal and organic material. And coming to the VAT photopolymerization, so that was the first technology. So earlier used to have only polymers, but now you are able to even using a VAT system, you can even make the ceramics. So these are some of the, but you may have a different energy sources if you observe altogether, and the material categories or the material compatibility is also different from technology to technology. So let me start with the first classification, that is a VAT photopolymerization. Of course, it was the first among 7. Say VAT photopolymerization, name itself is telling you that there will be a VAT of material, and it works with the principle of photopolymerization, means the raw material may be which is photosensitive, and it may be subjecting to the powder chemistry called polymerization process. So basically with that it will work. So and as I already mentioned, SLA was the first technology under this, and the raw material is the plastic. So and this was the first technology, but now you have a good developments are happening. So instead of using a laser, a single point laser to cure this plastic, so people are using a projector or LED or a LCD based or the DED kind of a technology. They are using it instead of a single laser, so which you may have very faster. So but the material remains same, that is photosensitive polymer resin, that is a thermoset plastic. And under this you have a different companies, right, from the 3D systems, Form Labs and DWS, and under this you have Envision Tech and other players. And Carbon 3D is one which it is called a continuous digital light processing. So let me play these videos. So SLA was the first technique, you know how it works. Majority of the people are very much familiar about this technology called stereolithography operators. So the raw material is taken as a liquid. And of course, which you can see, these are the supports. And these are some of the parts which made out of this SLA technology, where people used to use for the prototyping purpose. Why? Because it was the earlier process, the where it was started with only the polymers, that is epoxy resins. And these are some of the systems where industrial systems are bigger systems, which can capable of printing relatively big sized prototypes. So this is what how it works, means you have a laser. So laser will be curing the liquid resin. So you have a recoater, and of course you have to start with the CAD model. So as usual, like you start with any one of the CAD modeling technique or a video gaming data. So you have to start with that. And this raw material is a liquid and there is a laser, and first the leveling of the liquid layer will do, and of course as for the cross sections which you have already sliced in the computer or the software, so as for that your the recoater will spread a very thin film of liquid, and now the laser will come and trace the cross section, rather than it will start curing or it will start polymerizing. Basically you have a monomer, and this is against to the photosensitive polymer material, and now the next second layer, so it is spreading, or it is creating a next thin film of liquid material, and the laser will so do layer by layer, and finally you are going to get this kind of part which is made out of epoxy resin. So that is about the SLA process, where you used to use a single laser, but now you have a DLP or a LCD techniques. So, but anyway, you have to start with a CAD model. So either DLP or a LCD technology, which is 40 times faster than the SLA system. Why? Because you have only the single point laser in SLA, but whereas in a DLP or a kind of your LCD kind of a technology, so where you will be using a kind of a projector, as you know that how in a movie how you are going to screening the movie, so with the same principle you are going to have so in the digital light processing, so you are going to have the light, the projector, and which it will be projecting onto the screen, so onto that, where it is getting layer by layer, it is getting with this you are able to print that one layer at a time, so it is very faster than instead of a single point laser, so you have the entire projector, so which this projecting the light, the photosensitive curable, and this is the projector which it will be curing rather than, and of course LCD, so it is almost similar technology where your LCD phone will work, so the LCD technology, but you have a drawbacks of LCD technology, it is not so popular like the previous one, but of course it may have its some advantages also, but it is not so popular like DLP, but DLP is so popular, so it works with again the same entire layer will be sintered, and of course it was the early system, as we know that SLA you have only a single point laser, so that is operating at milliwatts of power normally, so you have a low force or a low watt laser which it will be sintering, or it will be curing the layer, just we have seen in the previous video. So this is about the DLP technology, but you have CDLP, that is continuous digital light processing. There is a slight difference between the DLP and this is from Carbon 3D. So what is that difference is, here also you are going to have a projector, and of course which we can see this is an end usage part for one of the application of this screw compressor rotor, so where it has to fit it, this is a final part or end usage part where this will go and fit into this so you have this assembly, and where this screw will go and fit it here, so and this is an AC compressor, so this is not a prototype, this is a working model, so then you have to start with the you have a projector, a light projector, which it will, and of course this is a platform, and where the light projector will be projecting from this projector, light projector, so this is a light engine where the light will be projected, and of course you have this platform, and where the raw material, and you will be and basically you will be creating some kind of a oxygen permeable window that is in a very small sized window, and means we'll be creating some dead zone here, and it's very small size. If you see, this is the human hairs, and then almost 1/4 of human hairs, you will be creating a dead zone here. And then you will be keep on supplying your resin material, and which you can see. So you have a light projector, from the projector it will be projecting, and you have the permeable window, and where you are created dead zone, and the resin will be, and then where you can see the polymerization process is happening here. So once you have done that, so then we need to do the post curing. So you have a post curing operation here, so which it should create. You have some uncured, still you have an uncured polymer. So then we need to cure 100% through this photo or heat circulation, which we can see. So you will get 100% solid once it will undergo this post curing operation. So once you have done that post curing operation, once it got cured, now it is 100% solid part. So in this way it will work, the carbon 3D. So where now the final the part will be going to that assembly, rather than it is a working part, it is not a prototype like the earlier one. So you have a good developments are happening, and almost it is very faster than the previous systems. As I already mentioned, it may be 40 times faster than the previous systems. So let me go to the next slide. Actually, this VAT photopolymerization, we are talking about a DLP, or either you may have a laser galvanoscanning scanning in case of SLA, or a DMD, that is digital mirror device, or LCD, or it can be a holography. So as we have seen in the video how it works, I need not explain one more time here. Exactly, this is a schematic. And the materials, so you have a rigid, flexible, colorized, high temperature resistance material, a dental grade for dental applications, of course, some kind of a ceramic metal sintered. But of course, which you are using a ceramic or metal, it should be sintered. So debinding and sintering should be done. And you have, it's very fast process if you compare with the previous, it may be 1 centimeter per minute, that speed it may be going. So if you compare FDM and SLA, so but you have a very good resolution as far as SLA is concerned. So where you may be using 25 to 30 micron layer thickness, in contrast with FDM, you may use around 100 to 200 micron, but here 25 to 30. And of course the resolution is less than 40 microns, and you are going to get isotropic material and a smooth surface. And the problem here is entrapping volume because of this liquid, and there is some entrapped feature, and the liquid may get entrapped into that feature. So that may be the issue here. And of course, nowadays you have desktop printers also coming, like the SLA desktop printers. It's very cheap if you see, or even it can be further cheap, like this may be a bit medium cost, maybe $3,500, and you have even $279, which I have played a video previously. So this is a desktop kind of a LED based system. And of course 3D systems, this is the industrial grade, it's a very costly machine, as well as the materials also costly. So you have very costly machine to a desktop SLA machines also right now in the market available. And of course the carbon 3D, as I already explained with the video, so you have a very good futuristic kind of parts, like where you can customize your the soles. And then you can have some kind of helmets, which it is a customized helmet for which you can see inner, there is a lattice structure. So as I already explained in the previous session, like you can create a lattice structure. So that is the advantage where you can, otherwise you cannot get through any other conventional manufacturing processes. And let me talk about something on ceramics. So ceramics is also possible here, as I already mentioned. So SLA means not only polymer, but earlier used to have such kind of a feeling, but now you can even go with the ceramics also, how you can do a ceramics. And of course, which we need to start with the epoxy resin in a liquid form, and you take the ceramic powder and just you mix it in a mixer. So now you have the UV liquid and plus ceramic powder. And then of course, anyway, you start with the CAD model, slicing it, and 30 to 50 microns is the layer thickness. And then you slice it. And now you print it. So once you print it, and this is the printer, and where you can see now you have a slurry of ceramic slurry, which you are having as a raw material. So the ceramic powder is a slurry form, which you can see it is continuously pumping. And then of course you have some binder also here. So which it work with the DED, as I already mentioned, this is a digital micromirror device chip. So where it will be curing the material, and which you will be having a continuous the binder. And now you have a binder, and next we need to do a debinding operation. So in the debinder, so you will be debinding that the plastic binder which you have applied. So then it will be debinding, and once you are debinding it, and then which we need to use a final step, of course it will be sintering. So then once you have done this debinding, and final step is sintering, you do sintering, putting it in a sintering furnace. And of course, which we know that we need to, there is a shrinkage. The shrinkage 30% will be applied, the compensation of the shrinkage, and sintering final material property you are going to achieve. So once you have done the sintering process, so in this way, even you can make the through SLA, even you can make the ceramic parts also. Not only need not be the polymers earlier, but now which we can see, these are some of the ceramic parts which is after sintering, which you can see these are the ceramic parts, and of course which you can see for the investment casting. So you have unsintered, and this is a sintered, and this is what where you will be using for the bronze casting. So this ceramic shell will be used as for the bronze casting. So like this we can even use your SLA or DLP kind of technology for printing the ceramics. And of course you have a similar technology called lithography kind of a base ceramic manufacturing, as almost like a similar process which we discussed. You have a photochlorable slurry, and you have a DMD light exposed, and debinding, and final sintering. And you have a material choice like aluminum oxide, zirconium oxide, silicon nitride, hydroxyapatite, you have tricalcium phosphate, and silica based ceramics, which you can see. For ceramics, ceramic is a very good material for the dentist, where you can use for a kind of a bioabsorbable implants, where you can use hydroxyapatite is a very good substitute for the bone substitution. So our tricalcium phosphate is another material where for the dentist, so it will be quite helpful. And dental respirations or some ceramic static mixer, which you can see, these are some of the parts made from this ceramic based SLA process. And let me and go to the next kind of category, is a material jetting. So material jetting, it was started with a process called there is an Israeli company called Object. Now the Object is recently taken over by the Stratasys. So the material is like almost like a epoxy resin, which we have discussed previously. So instead of taking it in a vat, so what you are going to do, you will be curing with the same UV light and the same epoxy, but instead of taking it in a vat, so you will be jetting from the nozzle. So the raw material which you are going to jet from the nozzle, so that raw material is jetting from the nozzle. Of course, this is the design. So the advantage here is, if you are jetting from the nozzle, so you have a flexibility. So you can print the different materials rather than. So then which you can see, there is a flexible material and rigid material. With the same part, we can print it in a single go. So like where you can see some, these are the cartridges where you can have a different colors or different material. So which the material will be jetting, and simultaneously your UV light is exposing, rather than it will be curing like the earlier case. So instead of vat, just you are using an inkjet print, like inkjet printer. So you will be jetting the material from the nozzle, and simultaneously you will be curing it. So like that it will work. So once you complete this part, and of course you have a supports, like you have some kind of a wax kind of a supports, which you can see here. So, and then take out that part from the platform and use some kind of a water jetting technique to remove the supports. And once it is ready, so now you can see there is a water jetting station. Just you can remove further the any supports are left out. So in this way, we can make the different materials, and like it may be a flexible material, rigid material, opaque, or it may be a kind of transparent, like it's a combination. So in a single go without assembly, so we can print these kind of a parts. So that is another advantage. So once you are having a material jetting system with you, so you can have different materials you can print simultaneously as a single part. Otherwise, you should have done separately and you should have assembled it. But which has already said, like a part consolidation is the advantage of 3D printing or additive manufacturing. So we can make in a single as a single part instead of making separately and then assembling it. But there are recent developments are happening. I think this DOP is a older technology only, like probably SolidScape was the name. Instead of plastic, you may have a wax here for the injection, for the investment casting applications, you need to have the wax pattern. So then you will be jetting a wax instead of, earlier you have jetted the plastic. So instead of plastic, you melt the wax and jet it from the nozzle, and where you will get a wax pattern and use it for the investment casting application. But whereas there is a very good breakthrough, even you can see them, you can wonder how the metal will be jetted, right? So there is a X-Jet company, so they are able to even jet the liquid metal. So that is the breakthrough in this material jetting system. So what these X-Jet nanoparticle jetting, they are claiming that so they can even you can able to make metal through this kind of a material jetting system. So we need to prepare a nano sized particles, liquid particles like this, so and then you can jet these liquid nano particles. Of course, any additive manufacturing system, it has to start with the CAD model, and there is no what you call. So here there is no laser, or what you are trying to do is just you are able to jet these particles so through a nozzle. So then it is, so you are able to jet it, the metal, but you have definitely, you may have a different challenges if you are jetting the metal in a liquid form. So definitely there will be challenges, but still this is the commercial machine recently they launched. So the X-Jet, where we can see these are the liquid metal thing which is coming out. So you have a nanoparticles, metal nanoparticles, of course, and then you will be, and which you can see the tremendous, the 2 micron laser sized, the layer thickness. And that is wonderful. So you have started with 200 microns, and then SLA 20 micron, now you are talking about 2 micron. So it's wonderful. And of course the temperature will vary from the, what kind of a material you are printing it. So which you can see, these are the some of the metal parts, those are coming out from the X-Jet technology. There is very small size, and of course the accuracy is also reasonably good. So this is what where the developments are happening. So metals, even people are able to jet it through a material extrusion process, not only polymers and not only wax. So even people are able to even, you know, jet the metals also. That is the recent development is happening under this material jetting. And of course the world, same world PolyJet system, Stratasys has acquired UV curable polymers. You have a rigid and elastic, and of course you have a multicolor and a transparent, which you can have very beautiful models, which you can, and of course it will support multi colors, which you can see these many colors, like phantom colors also it will support. And of course even with the same competitor of Stratasys, 3D Systems also having a multi-jet printing technology, polymers plus wax can be done. And just now we have seen X-Jet, so where you are able to metal, even ceramics can be in similar way. You can even print the ceramics. These are the metal parts and ceramic parts. And of course, it depends on the temperature, means it depends on the what kind of a material you are printing it. And there is a very good technology. I don't have much of the time to discuss, but there is a very good technology from Optomac saying that aerosol jet printing. So this is also another area for electronics. So you can print even a smartphone, antennas, or any electronic devices. It's amazing technology. And just now we have seen this is normally you have a powder bed. This is a powderless, actually. Normally metal means you may be in the impression that only through powder bed or a DED system, but even this is a powderless technology for the metals, and high speed maybe they are climbing 5 times faster than the powder bed systems, and smooth surface finish, and then extremely low shrinkage, maybe 8 times lesser than the injection, metal injection. It may be similar to the injection molding, metal injection molding machine. So, and if you compare, it may be 8 times lesser than the shrinkage in terms of a conventional injection molding, metal injection molding, and isotropic uniformity and 99% 9 tenths. And of course, you have temperatures, again depends on what kind of a material you are printing it. And you have another technology from Vader. So Vader is also claiming they could able to print a molten metal, or they could able to jet a molten metal. That is through, there is a molten metal here, and the raw material is the aluminum wire. So they are feeding it, and there is a pulsed input voltage. So basically it will work with a kind of electromagnetic pulsing. So then you could, and of course you may have argon gas, as we know that even to avoid the oxidation. So, and this is what they are claiming, like where they could even able to, you know, jet this kind of metal, you know, in spite of a powder jetting system. They are claiming that, so there will be a nozzle, a ceramic nozzle, and where your molten or a liquid metal is coming in the form of a droplet, maybe which you can see, this is the ceramic nozzle. From the ceramic nozzle, maybe 50 micron a droplet, the metal droplet is coming and it will be depositing. So, and this is the another advancement where you can see under this kind of material jetting, whereas which you can even print the metal objects. So not only printing the polymers, even you can print the metals through material jetting system. And of course, similar way for the ceramics. So Exit, as I already mentioned, instead of a metal, which you have seen a video, so even you can print the ceramics, and it can be a steel and ceramic also. So then there are a lot of developments. You have flexibility here in terms of what you call the jetting nozzle. Otherwise, in a powder bed, you doesn't have a scope to introduce one more material. And coming to the next technology called binder jetting. So binder jetting, the name suggesting you that you may have a binder. There won't be any laser, or neither a laser nor any other heating element here. So just it's a binder, to and that binder may be jetting through the nozzle. So of course, you have an old technology called Z-Corp. Actually, this technology was originated from MIT. This is very famous, called as a Z-Corp machines. So this was the one of the early systems, like that was during early 90s. It was called as 3D printing, actually, from MIT. So this technology used to call as 3D printing technology, but now ASTM has classified and renamed it as a binder jetting. Why? Because you are jetting the binder onto the powder. The raw material is a powder, and you will be jetting the binder onto the powder to get the fusing or the bonding between the powder particles. And of course, you can take out, debind it, and do some kind of infiltrant or coating, and then further you can enhance the properties of the printed parts. And of course, this is well known, or the older technology, but now you have a lot of advancements are happening. So you have X1 is the company where somebody was asking in the first session, how can we print sand cores? And this is the machine for you. It will print the sand as the raw material. The sand cores and the sand molds will be printed. So the raw material, of course, is the powder in form, the sand in a powder, either a silicon or a zircon based sand. And then you have to start with, of course, the CAD model. And basically, it is a binder jetting where you can see once you make this sand core, and then these are the sand cores, so then you can very much create a mold, and then you can pour the casting. And this is during the printing, where you can see the binder is getting jetted onto the sand particles, sand powder. So this is what you are going to get, a kind of, and of course you start with the CAD model, and this is the raw material as a powder, and which it will be spreading, and the binder will be, and which we can see how this binder is getting, and then it is going into the spherical powder particles, and which it's going to get, creating a bonding between the powder particles through this binder. So then you can create that kind of a bonding between these powder particles, and then you will be jetting millions of droplets per second. So it is a very fast process, which you can ultimately going to get a kind of a sand core or sand mold, and then use it for the casting, and then you will have your either you can go with the sand printing, or even same way you can do the metal printing also. Or ceramics also. That is the, so you bring the raw material in the form of a powder, either it is a sand or a metal or a ceramic. So, and of course, X1 metal, anyway, I don't have time to play all these videos, but it works with the same principle. Instead of a sand, you have a metal powder. And the late entrant in this is a HP. As we know that HP is, they are pioneers in 2D. And now that the HP, they have come out with the multi-jet fusion technology. So means you are going to, the raw material is a plastic, which is a polymer. So which you will be jetting, of course you have a raw material as a powder in form, and which you will be spreading the powder onto the bed, and where you have something like your inkjet nozzle. So the binder will be jetting, or initially, actually, HP, they are very good, precise 3D printers they got in a 2D domain. And similarly, they have a mark here. So actually, they are using two kinds of, one is a fusing agent, and another one is a detailing agent. So because of fusing agent, you will get the bonding between the powder particles. And because of detailing agent, so you will get a colors, actually. So this is a color a printer. So where you can print, or you can, it will be, your detailing agent will enhance the resolutions of the resolution of the features also, and even it will add the colors also. So this is what the HP has coming to recently into this technology called as a multi-jet fusion technology under the binder jetting classification given by the ASTM. So just now we have seen basically it combines the binder jetting, and of course you may be IR light will be used for the voxel jet or even HP also. Like you have the raw material, as you know that this is the powder particles, and you have then absorption ink, and which you will be jetting from the inkjet nozzle, and of course you may use IR light to and finally you will be sintering, and you are going to get this kind of a structure. And of course you can go with this kind of materials, like you can have a very big volume from the voxel jet technologies where you can print, and of course it may be 10 to 100 times faster than the other technologies under this space. And of course the same thing you can apply for the ceramics. So ceramics means first you use a binder jetting process, debinding and sintering. So these are the steps we need to follow. And these are some of the ceramic printed parts, silicon carbide, alumina, zirconia, and boron carbide. So these are the parts which are printed out from this binder jetting. And of course, as I already mentioned, metals can be possible through the binder jetting. And these are some of the metal honeycomb kind of structures where we can see. And these are printed through a binder jetting metal system, like where it have a large parts like a sand molds for the casting, and no heat applied during the printing. You have a less stress. That is another advantage which we are going to get out of it here. And of course, it may be a less expensive than your lasers and other DED systems, and oftenly more cost effective. That's what I'm talking about. And parts are supported by loose powder. There won't be any support separately required here. And sintering process can cause the deformation, and then you have the powders like sand, ceramic, plastic, metal, and binder used as a phenolic binder or aqueous or silicate. So depends on the combination, like what kind of a powder, and choose the appropriate binder. And of course you have a high volume, low cost parts, and these are some of the parts are printed through this binder jetting metal, and we'll go to the next process. And well established or very well known technologies, extrusion based systems. Why? Because the Scott-Crump patent got expired, so 6 or 7 years back, and now you have a rep movement, and then people like Akash, so like from India, so we are proud that we have one, at least one good vendor for at least for the polymer printing in India. Like thanks to the RepRap movement, like where you have a open source you can even use the DIY kinds of kits. Why? Because it's an open source. RepRap movement has come from University of Bath and subsequently the US universities. So then it is very popular. FDM is a very popular, of course, you know that it's a plastic, but now you could be able to print composite, and for your surprising, even you can print the metals also through extrusion based FDM technology. And probably you are very much familiar about the FDM technology, where you have the raw material as a filament form, and then you have a nozzle and which it will be extruded, rather than it will be heated and melted, and then in a semi-solid state it will be falling onto the platform and it will getting fused one layer upon other layer. So you may have a model and support combination. So you have a model as well as support spool, and wherever you have model, and your model material will extrude and deposit, and wherever you have a support, and the support nozzle will come and deposit. Where you can see the model is a black and the white is a support, is a combination which you are able to print them, and then you take out the part and do remove the supports either through breakaway manually or use some kind of a solvent solution to remove the supports, as well as use some kind of hand sanding, and finally you are going to get that kind of a surface finish. And you have a lot of applications, as you know that this is a very popular technology called FDM technology, right? And as far as composites are concerned, it may be there is a company called Markforged. So Markforged, so they are coming out with a kind of a composites, same logic, like it's like the filament, the raw material is a filament form, it is getting extruded through the nozzle, and of course you have choked carbon fiber reinforced nylon, which we can see there will be two heads, one will be one material and this reinforcement will be done with the other nozzle. So and where you can see there is a carbon fiber and even a fiberglass or a Kevlar, or you have a fiberglass. So you have which we can see these are the composites where it got printed. So of course, as you know that the advantage of the composite, so it's lightweight but it's giving a very good strength. So and works with the same principle FDM, so there is no much difference here, like but you can go with the composites. So and then finally, of course, you can have metals also. Now you are able to 3D print the metals through FDM or through and don't say FDM or extrusion based system, we can put it as for the ASTM standard, it is extrusion based system. So through extrusion based system, even you could be able to print the metal. How it is you are able to print the metal? And of course you have to start with the CAD model and the RAM. Is for ceramic or the binder basically. So then you can print simultaneously the metal and as well as the ceramic, and which you have that binder and which it should be debind it. So then next step will be debinding. So once you're done printing and then do debinding it, and once you're done the debinding, and finally we need to do a sintering. So this is the final step, the sintering, and once you're done the sintering, so you're going to get the full-fledged component. So and then you can take out this part from the sintering station, and where you can see, so after removing that the supports, then you will have the metal part is ready. This is done through FDM process or extrusion based system. This is from Desktop Metal. There is a company called Desktop Metal. So then FDM, as we know, that started with the filament. The filament either a PLA or ABS or a PI, PEI, PC, and of course, just now we have seen either a metal, ceramic, or a fiber filler. So FDM, this is a status is, and you have a different configurations, as you know, that you have a Cartesian or a delta, or you have a conventional. This is a rep-rap movement, or rather than is the Cartesian kind of a coordinates or a delta kind of a coordinates. You have a different configurations of these machines. And materials, as we discussed, thermoplastic like a PLA or nylon, or you have a TPU or easy wood, and of course under the composites you have a nylon 12 CF, and then you have a embedded continuous carbon fiber laser from Mark Forge, and just now we have seen the metal. So you have the metal rod, and then you have a metal part, and of course similarly for the ceramic. So of course for the metal and ceramic it requires a sintering also. It's the 316 steel, and they are saying other materials also possible. And this is the clay paste, and I think Akash was showing some kind of construction material which you are able to print. So you have even it can be printed a ceramic, or it can be a concrete like a contour crafting or whatever you call, or it can be a clay pasted which you can have a kind of a ceramic can be, which you can see all these layers, layer by layer it's extruded, and these are some of the lattice structures or a kind of a clay paste. And of course FDM can be done, ceramics can be done through FDM. So you have and of course ceramics, there will be a challenge, ceramic as will be having a typical material, as you know that. So you have oxide ceramic filaments, you have aluminium zirconia, and you have silicon carbide, or you can have a nitrides like a silicon nitride, and like metal like steel or tungsten carbide. So this is some of the, and of course the sintering temperature will vary as for your material. And of course you have the fiber layering or a weaving through a carbon or a kind of a ceramic fiber reinforced composite materials. So and companies like Airbus, so this is one of the Airbus case study where the carbon fibers are braided onto a aircraft component, and you have a leaf fan blades also, and this some of the fiber just now we have seen from the Mark Forge. So these are the carbon fibers are embedded in the continuous carbon fibers. So, and of course, desktop metal, as we discussed, you have a rod, print, debind, and then sinter. You have the material as a steel. So, no laser, no powder, and spare. You have infill. Of course, you have a sparse, and infill is possible through FDM technology. That is the advantage, as we know that. So, you have been using it for your FDM printers also. And you can have a ceramic supports to release the layers, of course, which we have seen in the video also, and save for the office environment. These are some of the advantages. And see the cost, if you compare with the metal powder bed system, almost it may be cheaper. And of course, and coming to the sheet lamination process is the next kind of additive manufacturing process. The old technology was helices, where the raw material is taken in the form of a sheet, and you will be rolling that sheet, and then you may be using a laser to cut the cross sections. That was the journey of sheet lamination started with the LOM LEC system. But then people realized why you want to cut the paper kind of material with the laser, and company like Mcar, so they have come out with a different idea. So actually they have come out with ordinary A4 size paper or a legal sized paper as the material. So we can, it is almost looks like our office printer. So the raw material is, here is a paper, and this paper will be rolled here. And then apart from this, and it will take all the file formats like OBJ or STL or things like that. And then once you have the CAD model with you, and then roll the paper and do some kind of adaptive build, and you have inkjet printer to give the colors. So it's a wonderful technology, and it's very cheap also, where you can produce different colors of the components, where you can see some of the components like this, and even you can get it scanned yourself, and these are some of the articles where it got printed through this Mcar Irish technology, the sheet lamination process, where you can see This is nowadays, it is something like your 2D printer, extension of the 2D printer, like it looks like office printer, right? So you have, that is a technology from MCAR. And of course, you can have fiber reinforced composites can be done through LOM. So how do you do that? There is a company called Impossible Objects. So you can, somebody was asking maybe, so can you do it a fiber reinforced composites? Yes, this is the technology for you. So you can make a fiber reinforced composites. So like as usual, I had to start with the CAD model, and this is the CAD model, and which you can see this is the fiber sheet to print, and then use the inkjet heads to contain a wetting fluid to print on the object, which is shape of the fiber sheet, which you can see on that. And of course, you may be using a polymer powder over the fiber sheet, and where it will be wetted the layer shapes. And once you have done, then you remove this non-adhesive powder, and then you can put it into, say, once you have done this, all these, then put it laminated. You stack these laminates and then put it in a temperature or where you can have that the polymer, will be removed or debinded. And once you have done that, so we remove that uncoated fibers. And then once you remove that uncoated fibers, and this is what you have left out with your part. So like that, there will be a lot of developments are happening. It's just not like previously what we'll be talking about these technologies. And of course, even metal is also possible. So there is a process called ultrasonic consolidation. So where this is the hybrid process. So you will be, we'll be doing what you call the welding process. This is a solid state welding. So you'll be using a sonotrode to do a welding and do some tires welding, and then followed by milling. So it's a hybrid process. So where the advantages of layered manufacturing, and the advantages of subtractive manufacturing process. So you're going to get both of them in a single process, like ultrasonic consolidation. So where you can print, and of course, as and when you have the subtractive process, you may have a lot of wastage though. But anyway, so you're going to get the advantage of both additive and subtractive process by using this kind of hybrid process like ultrasonic consolidation. So where you will be starting with the CAD model, of course, and then you will be finally end with a kind of a metal die like this. So of course, you will be doing a finally, it's a combination. Sometimes you do weld and sometimes you do a kind of welding and end milling. So both combinedly, and finally you got this metal die part. So in this way, so where even sheet lamination, so you can print the metals also in this way. And so in the form of a sheet or in the form of a tape, just we have seen. And MCAR, as I already said, there is an inkjet printer kind of a thing, and where these some of the parts made out of. And ultrasonic consolidation, just now we've seen in the previous video, and where you will be having ultrasonic welding and CNC. And of course, maybe laser contour machining also, like it's a combination, it's a hybrid process. And then of course, which we have seen in the previously, is the composite, the fiber reinforced composites. And UC, anyway, I'm not going to in depth. Actually, coming to the applications, you have a functionally graded laminates, it's quite possible, and embedded electronics, which you can see, and you can have a metal matrix composites. So the metal matrix composites or silicon carbide fibers are embedded into your metal laminates. So this is a very good developments as far as sheet lamination. And anyway, this we have already seen in the form of a video, how we are able to generate these kind of a fiber reinforced composites. And then next we'll talk about the powder bed. Now it's very famous a process, as we know that. So in this process, it has started with a polymer. Actually, the SLS is for processing the polymer from the 3D systems. And then company like UAS or SLM or 3D systems, they have come out with a different approach rather than doing partial melting. So they are using a full melting here. So you can even melt the powder particles instead of sintering it. So you are able to melting the powder particles, and through the high powered lasers, as you know that. So the raw material is a powder, and using the laser, and which you can get these kind of metal parts from the powder to metal part by using a laser technology to melt the powder particles. Anyway, start with the CAD model and send it to the machine and do kind of melting through laser, and then you remove the substrate and do remove the supports and do some kind of polishing or kind of a sanding, or use some kind of finishing tools to finally get your metal part. So and instead of laser, now people are coming out with an electron beam. So this is one of the development. So electron beam, it will be having its own advantages compared to laser, but it may be having disadvantages also if you compare with the laser. But company like Arcam, so recently GE has taken over this company. The Arcam is a Swedish company. So where you are going to use an electron beam rather than a laser, but rest will be same. You start with metal powder, and then you have to feed that metal powder through. You have a roller or a kind of a separator. What you call the blade or a roller, which will recoater basically. The recoater will spread the powder like other powder bed systems. And then instead of laser, you may be using an electron beam, the high power electron beam. So you may be using it here as an energy source. And of course, you have to create a vacuum. So this is a vacuum chamber, and where we can see, this is one of the GE component of turbine blade, titanium aluminide material. And they are using left and right these technologies. As you know, that their aim is to make these metal gas turbine engine parts and other aviation parts. So that's what. And this is about the electron beam technology from GE rather than Arcam. And then, of course, you have Valo. Valo is the one latest technology. Whatever drawbacks which normally you have in a powder bed, the supports is a major criteria. But these guys are saying that the overhang, even it can be a 5 to 10 degrees. So normally the overhang is 45. That also we have discussed in the previous session. But normally wherever you have less than 45 degrees overhang, then we need to give a support. So, but these guys, they are telling, so it doesn't require it. The 45 is reduced to 5 to 10 degrees. That's what they are claiming it. But anyway, it's relatively new technology in the market, and where it works with the same principle, like how other powder bed systems work. It works with the same principle. So you have laser, and of course, which it will be melted the powder particles. But the advantage they are saying that support structure is the main headache in any powder bed metal sintering or the melting, and SLS, SLM, which we have discussed, and then of course EBM is also discussed. And the parameters, as you know, that some laser parameters like laser power, scan speed, layer orientation, hatch distance, so it may be judging a lot for your quality and other properties of your metal 3D printed parts. This is what I'm talking about Valo. They're saying that it is 10 degree. The overhang is 10 degree, and it may be 40 mm inner dimensions. And aspect ratio, normally it is 80:1, but they are claiming 500:1. So it's quite possible that's what they're claiming. But anyway, these are some of the, without supports they have generated, that's what they're claiming it. So this is a very good development, really. So once under this metal, so normally what we do is the recoating and lasing is done. We never do simultaneously, but these guys, they are telling that so you can simultaneously recoat, and you can simultaneously, what you call, you can lase it. So that's what they are telling, and it is a 55 times faster than the market available printers. That's what they are claiming. And print speed is also, it may be normally it's a speed is say 1.3 kg per day, but they are targeting to 1,000 kg. So, but anyway, these are very recent and upcoming technologies where I'm trying to give across the globe whatever maybe the developments are happening. And of course, powder bed is quite ceramics. Also, people are trying. It's like it can be a direct SLS or it may be indirect SLS, where you can see some of the direct SLS parts, and this is indirect through aluminium, and this silicon carbide, aluminium. Alumina indirect SLS, and of course SLM. These are some of the alumina based ceramic materials which it got printed through powder bed system. And now the coming to the last part of technology that is a directed energy deposition. So directed energy deposition, it is something like welding. It seems like a welding. Why? Because you will be creating an melt pool or an arc or something like that, and then you will be pumping the raw material powder through these nozzles, and there will be a high powered laser, and on the substrate you will be generating a kind of a melt pool and then keep on supplying your powder, and it will be having its unique advantage. Like you have already machined part, and top of it you can do it, or you can do repairs, and you have a flexibility here. Nowadays you have a 5-axis systems also coming up, so you have a lot of flexibility. And even electron beam, same is a laser, and even you can have a electron beam is also do your job from Siaki. So this is one of the electron beam is used as energy rather than a laser, and which you may get a near net shape parts, and further you may use machining or some kind of a post processing, which you can see. This electron beam, and of course the raw material is a wire or the rod or the what you call. So you can feed, it's a wire fed. The material may be tantalum or titanium or steel. So which we can see, you may have a dual wire feeding also, or right now it may be a single wire, and then you have an electron beam. So, and then of course you may have a 5-axis rotation of this table, and of course you have a dual wire also. No, it's quite possible. So, and this is about, and you have a plenty of applications right from the defense, and this is from the Siaki. So this is, and of course you may have other technology, wire arc additive manufacturing. So wire arc additive manufacturing, as you know, that it's almost like you are welding only, right? A TIG or a MIG. So you start with, what you call? So you can have a kind of welding torch, right? And then you have a plasma welding, which we can see it's quite similar to the welding. That's about, what you call, the wire arc additive manufacturing. So which you will be using, and of course I don't have much time, then I have to rush it. Okay, so this is about the DED systems, and as we discussed, you have either a laser a powder combination, or either it can be a wire or electron beam combination. So, and Siaki, this we have just now have seen. And beauty here is, even you have a cold spraying metal printing printers also, which is almost like a normal, typically it is a 4 kg per hour through EBM or your DED machine speed. So it may be 9 kg per hour. But if you come to the cold spraying metal printing, it may be 45 kg per hour. So you, almost you have 5 times faster, rather than which you can handle that much quantity of powder. So we may have a lot of developments are happening under this. And of course you do ceramics is quite possible. Even people are, company like Optomec, so they are developing a ceramic composite matrices or a composite ceramic, or it can be a pure ceramic like aluminum, zirconia or silica. So then let me talk about finally, so what could be the post-processing techniques that we have learned about all 7 AM processes. So then post-processing techniques is playing a vital role definitely in additive manufacturing in order to attain a kind of improvements in the properties, or cost is also like the cost, the product cost is also, the post-processing is contributing a lot. So maybe SLS or a binder jetting, it may be, sometimes it may be 70% of your part cost may go towards the post-processing also. And FDM, as we are very much familiar, and people have been using it as a domestic printer, right? So FDM is a very well known, and you may use a cutting or a kind of a solvent, to dissolvable solvent to remove the supports. And then you do as kind of a solvent, vapor solvent or sanding or bead blasting or tumbling or coating. So you can do any one of these post-processing on FDM printed parts. Or it can be if you talk about SLS. So SLS is basically a powder-based system, which we need to remove from the powder bed, and then we need to remove the supports also. But maybe maybe if it is a metal, but polymers it doesn't require. But anyway, you can go with the bleed blasting or sand blasting is a kind of thing which you can improve the surface finish. Tumbling machining will also support. On top of it, we can do the machining also. And for SLA, you do washing and post curing is the post processing operation which we need to do for every component. We need to do a post curing for the SLA and of course washing. You have some kind of this is the only technology normally you work with what you call the chemicals or the acids, something like TPM kind of acid you work with SLA. And we need to remove the supports and we can coat it otherwise. And jetting, like the polyjet, there's a material jetting, you can use a support removal and dissolvable supports. Or binder jetting, we need to debind it and we need to sinter it. So after each and every part, we need to debinding and should be followed with the sintering for the binder jetting technology. And which we can see there is a FDM as built part and after doing a kind of a solvent vapor smoothening. So which you can see how the appearance is enhanced. And nowadays you have exclusively post-processing machines is a very good business. So actually, if you see, this is previously it got FDM printed. But on top of it, where you can see there is a release ink means then after made on FDM technology and people are even printing an ink, releasing ink and then there may be special colors. So can you believe that this got FDM printed and then afterwards these colors has applied? So then you have a such kind of a post-processing machines also available in the market. And you have a support removal and support finishing. And of course, FDM you have, and if it is a metal, you have altogether different ball game. And you have a post-processing, this is a post-processing unit exclusively for SLA and SLM and FDM systems where you can use this other area where people are developing post-processing machines. And surface finishing is another area where we need to improve our importance, where we need to improve the corrosion or oxidation resistance, or surface friction and wear, tensile strength, you have bending fatigue and cellular and biofilm kind of adhesion or appearance. And normally this is as built and after finishing, which you can see how much difference is coming. And normally what kind of a methods do the surface finishing? Either go sanding, polishing, machining, and vibratory grinding, abrasive flow machining, short peening or blasting, and you have a chemical etching, electro polishing, vapor smoothening, electro deposition, dyeing, and you have a spray coating, a dip coating, whatnot. So you can have several methods to improve the surface finish. So this is one of the as built part. As built, it is typically say around 10 microns of RA value you will get through now powder bed system. But after doing a dry electro polishing, where you can see the RA value is now less than 0.1 RA value. So where you can see how much improvement in the through this post-processing technique. And of course, you may use a laser polishing, so which even maybe less than 0.3 microns. So as built, it may be a 7 microns. This is for kind of a knee implant. And then you have several things to do here, like in terms of post-processing techniques available in the market. So you can use these post-processing techniques to further improve your surface finish or even functionality. This is one of the example where you can have some antenna, RF antenna horn. So which it is after the kind of a super surface finishing, where you can see the performance of this antenna. Now it got improved. So you have the smoothening is also improving the functionality of the antenna here in this case. So that's a promising. And last but not the least, HIP, that is a hot isostatic pressing. So that is for metal, either SLM or EBM process, where we can see, we can have, before the HIPing, where you can see micro cracks or where the density may not be 100%. But after HIPing process, you can attain 100% density. As we know that HIPing is a high temperature, high pressure, and keeping it a long time, something like cooking in a pressure cooker, right? So then you can have this HIPing, so you can get 100% theoretical density, and which eliminate micro porosity, and which removes the printing defects, anything is there, and which removes the micro cracks also. And finally, it will improve the ductility, fatigue, residual stresses and wherever you have a critical resistances, and then high performance materials where we need to have this kind of heaping. So in order to improve these kind of properties, and of course the challenge here is the defect elimination without coursing, that is the microstructural, which will lowering the yield strength. Of course, there is a challenge also. And let me conclude with this slide. Like, what are the fabrication challenges that the AM industry is facing nowadays? So definitely standardization, lack of standardization of the parts is the major challenge that any AM industry is facing. Why? Because you cannot get a repeatability from machine to machine, or even run to run, the repeatability is varying. So that is the biggest challenge for AM community to face or to tackle this kind of a challenge. And of course, the consistency of the source, the reasons may be you must have a source material should be consistent, whatever you are taking, that powder or a wire or any form liquid. So it should come out with a kind of a standard source. So means the characterization, the powder characterization, so whatever it is coming in the which source, and it should right from the raw material. So then we need to check whether it is performing the consistently or not. And of course, process control and error correction. So this is another thing where we need to as a biggest challenge. And post-processing requirements is also another challenge. The post-processing, it may put a lot of cost, and it may have a lot of time to spend to do a post-processing, and of course the quality and certification of the parts. This is the biggest challenge. So you don't have we doesn't have the a kind of a gauge to say that whether you have produced a faulty part or a good part. Why? Because there are no proper certifications in this space. So that is another challenge for in front of us. And new potential health hazards, of course, you need to have particles, and then there will be a fumes, or you need to use some kind of precautionary measures or a kind of respirators or any kind of a thing, which you are, especially if you are working with the powder particles of the size 30 to 40 microns or so. And of course, it may even create some kind of a fumes. And integrity of the digital data, it is another issue. So where companies like GE and other people, they are working out kind of a blockchain technology to secure the data. And of course, finally, the last but not the least, so how do you protect the IPs? So that is the biggest challenge nowadays the AM industry is facing as far as the fabrication of the parts are concerned. So I think I have done it. So this is my, so I have done it within the time. Probably I might have exceeded 15 minutes. So Dr. Saxena was mentioning that 1 hour, 15 minutes. So I have done for 1 hour, 15 minutes. So, okay. So it is over to you. So any questions, I'm happy to answer. Yeah.
Session is open for question answers. Along with the question and answer session, I am launching the poll question to save the time. So first question is coming from Abdul Wahab Hash. Abdul, please ask your question.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, the question is regarding that. Can we use the AM process for repairing the damaged object? Or if you're using this for repairment of damage, so in which AM process can be best for in polymer and metal if you're using for repairment of any damage?
Yeah. So the repair will be done through DED, that is for metal. We can very much do a repair through DED system for the metals, but polymer I am not sure, but metal I am sure. The repairing, people have been doing a repairing of the metal parts, very critical metal parts, right? Say, for example, you have a gas turbine blades, or like marine engine parts, or maybe some military battle tanks, gas turbine engines. So those are very, the costly items, where it may be made out of super alloys, and then it's very costly, so you cannot scrap them out. Or if you want to do a conventional repair technique like welding, So heat affected zone is the major issue for doing a conventional welding technique to do a repair or to do a refurbishing of this kind of a thing. But additive manufacturing with the DED technology will give you a very a localized or the heat, kind of a heat affected zones are very less, and definitely the kind of a DED system will help you in this kind of a repairs or refurbishing. Yes, I hope I answered your question.
In the last year you have the advanced process, the cold spray based AM process. So I think so the cold spray is utilized for the repairment.
Correct. So, that is also can be done. Yeah, you are correct. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, it's a part of DED. It's a part of DED. Yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay.
Dr. Vikas Srivastava.
Hello. Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening.
So my question is, when we use nanoparticles, so how we can do a uniform mixing, or we can perform, how we can get the uniform distribution of nanoparticle in the matrix?
Yeah, actually, that is the challenging one. What they are saying that there is a kind of a proprietary kind of a method to do that. But still, it is not under what you call as a full-fledged commercial machine. No, you know, it is the upcoming technology, and there will be a lot of challenges. I do agree. So, but it is not a well-established technology so far. Yeah, so there will be a lot of challenge. It's different. I do agree with that. So, but it has to come in a commercial level. But still, it is under development only. That kind of system, what we have discussed about the nanoparticle jetting.
Oh. Yes. Okay. So thanks.
So actually, I'm seeing in the chat box that a lot of participants are saying that they have questions. So I'm requesting all the participants who have any question, please raise your hand so that I can unmute you and you can ask your question. So another question I'm taking from Tamino Kogi Ibrahim.
Yeah. Yeah, Ibrahim. Hello.
Yeah, Mr. Ibrahim, please go ahead. Actually, I'm unmuting you, but I think it's muted from your side. You please unmute you. Okay, I think some technical issue is there. Another question is from Jaya Prashad Vanam.
Okay. Yeah, Jaya Prashad.
Yes, sir. I'm very
Jaya,
nice presentation.
Jaya,
sir.
Please hold down. First question is now on. Yeah, Tamino, please, you carry on.
It's Tamino Ibrahim from Nigeria. Please, I want to know if it's going to be possible for AM technology to be used to produce composite aluminium brake discs.
Composite aluminium and?
Brake discs.
No, I'm not sure, like, whether it is possible. I'm not sure. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Jay Prashad, you please.
Yes, sir. I'm Jay Prashad from J&T Kakinada, sir.
Yeah, Jay Prashad.
Thank you very much for your enlightening the very advances in the additive manufacturing. So my question is about the finishing operations, sir. So like for curved surfaces, which is the best method for the finishing additive manufacturing products? Other than the sandblasting, you have mentioned about.
Yes, yes. Yeah, definitely. No, I even honestly, I don't have a much hands-on on this post-processing techniques. So definitely it is better to have a kind of not. Anyway, sandblasting may not be work out for good, but it may be like other techniques. It may work out maybe through other one which we have discussed, which I listed. Probably it may be the right choice. But I honestly, I don't have experience to work on this post-processing. No, which material you are, technology, which material you are talking about?
By using SLM for titanium alloys. Yeah.
Okay, metal one. Okay.
Metal one only, sir. And sir, you have mentioned you have recently have got the equipment.
Yes.
So may I know the table dimensions, sir?
No, we are around, it's a small build, around 100 by 100 by 100. Yep.
Okay.
Yes, 100 by 100 by 100. Yes, yes.
Thank you very much, sir.
So one question I'm taking from participants whose profile name is DAPO. DAPO. Mm-hmm. I'm unmuting you. Please ask your question as you are writing in the chat box that you have raised many times your hand and never we have given you the opportunity to ask questions. Now you please ask your question.
Thank you. Good evening, sir. Please, my first question goes this way. Mm-hmm. What is the difference between FEA meshing and tessellation?
Okay, meshing and, okay, meshing versus?
Okay. And tessellation, yes.
Tessellation, okay. Yeah, so FEA is, so it's a kind of elementary kind of discretization. You may have a different elements. And if I am correct, I am not expert in FEA actually. If I am correct, it's also a mesh, fine. But tessellation is also a mesh. But every time tessellation, it's only triangle. You cannot vary the other element shape or other other element shapes. Normally you do for FEA meshing. You can have a lot of elements to work. But tessellation, you don't have a flexibility as far as STL file is concerned. So you have only the triangle is the element or the facet or the cell or the or kind of unit cell. It's a triangle. And more or less, it is a kind of mesh. It is not a solid model. So it's a mesh. Okay. Like FEM. I am not sure. I am not an expert in FEM. FEA, I don't know. But I am concerned about the tessellation. So definitely, it is a mesh. It is not having any volume, or it is not having any material, or it is not having any topology. Yes, so it doesn't have nothing. So just it is only a triangular outer surface of your model is approximated or represented with a triangle. So nothing is there inside. So it is it's a mesh. It's a triangular mesh. Okay. Yes.
Okay. Yes. Thank you, sir. Question number two, sir. Mm-hmm. Please, what is the place of a lathe machine and milling machine in additive manufacturing?
No, I am not getting your question. So lathe and...
What I'm asking is it all the work which milling machine can do that additive manufacturing also can't?
Okay, means so wherever you have some hybrid process, we are talking about that one, say some of the hybrid process, like it's a combination of additive and it may be a end milling cutter, end milling process, CNC. It's an end milling process, yeah. But lathe machine, I don't know, like whatever I discussed. So if you talk about ultrasonic consolidation, so that is a one kind of hybrid kind of a process where you will be doing some layers with the ultrasonic welding and then followed by milling, that is end milling cutter. With that you are consolidating or you're removing and getting the surface finish as good, like you are exploiting combining these two in a hybrid way. So it is an end milling process. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Last question, sir. So at what stage of additive manufacturing can we determine or carry out mechanical and material properties of the product?
Mechanical properties of?
Of the product. At what stage of the production?
Okay. So if you want to compare with the traditional or conventionally made part, mechanical strengths and the AM part, you want to compare, that's your question. So what could be the gap between these two? Is that the question?
Yes, and at what point can we in the manufacturing process? At what point along the process do we carry out the test?
Okay, so actually you want to do a mechanical testing of additively manufactured parts, that's what you're asking?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So actually, unfortunately, we don't have a well-established procedures like you have ASTM. As we know that for the traditional processes, you have a well-established ASTM standards to do a testing. But I'm not sure like it is having such kind of a maturity in terms of testing these parts like your conventional systems. But it's under development. You have a lot of ASTM committee, ISO and ASM. So they are working together to develop a lot of standards to come out. So maybe towards your mechanical properties, some materials you have established things, but still it has yet to evaluate other materials also. The problem here is, so it's you cannot generalize. So whatever methods or whatever the properties you are going to get out of this additively manufactured parts, why? Because each material will behave differently, and that too, it may be the curse, or we don't know. Like you are making a customized, personalized products, but how do you standardize these kind of bionic designs or totally a lattice structures? Normally you do 3D print, so definitely there will be a challenge for the standards also to evolve. So definitely, why? Because it is a disruptive technology, like as you know that. So it is not like a conventionally what you do the components. So definitely it has to have a kind of a lot of exercise for the standard agencies to generate or to evolve the standards for the components which it's getting the additively manufactured parts. So definitely there are no such standards foolproof or well established, but it is under development. Definitely some point of time we are going to see these kind of standards very soon with the good materials and good more number of materials and more number of processes and more number of applications which we can see these kind of standards or certifications or qualifications, whatever under this.
Thank you, sir.
So, sir, two more questions are there. If you permit, so I can say.
Sure. Yeah, go ahead.
Jagneshwar Nanda, please go ahead with your question.
Good afternoon, Ravi Kumar.
Yeah, good afternoon, Nanda.
Sir, thank you for your very good presentation. My question is that we have already prepared with the powder metallurgy, taking the aluminum and biomaterials as the filler. Now, okay. My question is there any process in additive manufacturing process where we can use these three?
Can you repeat what are those three?
Aluminium powder, aluminum powder, and bio powder.
Biocompatible material. One more thing. Okay. Aluminium. Yeah. Okay. Biocompatible
and
material.
And which less than 300 degrees centigrade.
no, actually. And normally you may have only the functionally graded materials as of now. You talk about DED, so DED can make FGMs, that is functionally graded materials, which we can vary the composition. But if you are saying totally different, no, I don't have any clue, but I don't think so. It means biocompatible material. Normally we have a well-established titanium 6-4. Or titanium alloy is there to have a biocompatible material. So you want
to... In order to study the crack analysis, we are doing that.
Okay. But you want to simultaneously print aluminium as well as titanium in a... No, I don't think so. It will possible. Why? Because you have a different melting... temperatures altogether, na? Titanium will be having aluminium.
Yeah.
And more or less both are reactive materials and on top of it. So So it may be very crucial.
But we have prepared it by.
Okay.
But we have prepared it by powder metallurgy.
Yeah, yeah. Powder metallurgy, you can prepare it. But only one option you can try, I can say, is only the DED process may. But I don't think so as such it can. But it may be possible with the DED, if at all, if it is possible. So it may, it should come through only DED process, not powder bed or not any other process. Definitely, if at all, if it is possible. So it is through DED only it has to come. Yeah.
Will the material functional properties will change, do you think?
No, that's what I'm telling. Like say, 100% my answer is not yes, but it may be possible, but I don't saying that it is possible, but 100% I'm not saying that it's possible. Thank you.
Last question of the today's session we are going to take. It is from Dinesh Rajesh.
Yeah.
Please ask your question.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. Myself, Dinesh Raj from ISRO, BSSC, Trivandrum.
Okay.
Sir, actually, I am working in the field of heat facility, HIP.
Okay.
Sir, first of all, you showered the ocean of data. Thanks for that. I'm just picking two things only. Sir, one is Velo 3D, you told. Velo 3D right. With the 5 to 10 degree, we can achieve.
Right.
How are they achieving, sir, in Snappies? Can you tell?
Yeah, that's what I'm telling. Actually, they are climbing, but even I don't have any clue to. This is under development. It's okay. Not under. Yeah, even that's what I am quite interesting. No, I'm very keen to know that if it is less than 5 degrees, then yes, people are struggling for 40, 45 degrees and
exactly.
50 degrees, even 50 also, 50, 55. Some powder bed systems, it requires less than 55 also. But 5, 10 degrees, even I am eager to see that.
Yes, I will also search it. Aspect ratio also 500 is 20.
That is mind-boggling. So if it is 50 or 80 itself, no. But 500 is to 1. But maybe we have to wait and see like how it's going.
Yeah, thanks for the update. We will work on that also.
Yes.
But second thing is NPJ. You told about metal, nanometal particle jetting.
Yes.
How the technology is evolved, sir? No, current situation.
No, even for that also, it is not under matured one, and it is under development. Is it to prove that?
Any Indian parties are there, sir?
I'm not sure, but
okay.
Indian agent. I don't think so. Maybe in India we are having agent. I don't think so.
Okay. Yeah. So third thing, I'm working in HIP actually. We are also developing the process through HIPing for post processing.
Mm-hmm.
We could also parallel developing without HIP also, we could achieve 99.99 in using the many softwares.
Great.
Yeah.
Yes.
But when we're applying, as you told, you were correct, like yield strength is getting reduced because of enlargement of grains.
Mm-hmm.
So that also we're working.
Very good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah.
Thanks
yeah.
for your good presentation.
Okay.
Dinesh. One more question I have to take. It is from Mukul Shukla from NIT Allahabad.
Okay.
And fortunately, he is my MTech supervisor too.
Okay. Yeah, I know him personally. How are you, Ji?
yes, Dr. Ravi, wonderful session. You know, I must compliment you.
Thank you.
Excellent sessions, wonderful compilation of literature.
Thank you. How are you?
Yeah, I'm absolutely fine. Pleasure meeting you.
Yeah.
This, you know, the collection will be very handy for your online teaching also in the forthcoming semesters.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Now, I only wanted, you know, towards one of your last slides, you showed on security using what blockchain. Was it?
Yeah, blockchain.
Could you throw some light on it?
People like GE, they are saying that they are. As you know, that the biggest challenge in the future, it's going to be the how we can protect our designs, right? So these designs, how we can protect and how we can secure this data. So definitely, it's a challenge for us to know securing our designs in the future also, like there will be a threat. But people are coming out some kind of blockchain systems or other security systems where you can secure the data. So that's my thing I can say. As of now, I don't have much of the data in that. But the idea here is like companies like GE and other people, they are developing their own system to a blockchain system to have secure or their designs, things like that. So they are working some kind of developing kind of a systems to do that, maybe towards their security purposes and all. Like maybe it's going to be the digital threat definitely we can face very soon, maybe under Industry 4.0, where your data is or as
sure.
You know that 3D printing is also more it is a design oriented, like where digital data is going to be the main key for the things where we are getting printed now, and in future also it's getting more demanded, such kind of a thing. Definitely we must have a challenge to how to secure our data designs and things like that. That may be the challenge definitely now and even future Industry 4.0 you are working under that scenario. So then definitely there must be a kind of a blockchain system to have a challenge to secure our data, our designs to be sure. Secured. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Wonderful. Pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you.
So we are going today's session to close here. I'm again very much thankful to Professor Ravi.
Thank you.
For taking two lectures and in a very highly energetic way. And a lot of contents he has delivered to enlighten the participants. Thank you very much, sir. Definitely we will be in touch in future again. And when the things will be normal, so definitely I will invite you personally to visit the GLN University.
Okay, thank you.
The land of Lord Krishna also.
Yeah, it's a pleasure for me.
So thank you very much, sir. Thank you all the participants. We'll meet in tomorrow's session at 11 sharp. Bye-bye, take care.
Yeah, bye.